Hi, my name is Griffin. We are finishing up our series on Soul, which, if you don't know, is based loosely off of the Pixar movie Soul and completely based out of the scriptures. You got to know that you were made with a soul. You are not just a human being with a heart and a body and a mind, but you are completely inwardly made with a soul that was designed for God. And if you don't know what your soul is for, where it comes from, and how to take care of that soul, you're going to have what we would like to call a restless soul. And I want to take these next few moments to talk to you about how to find rest for your soul. And I think and I'm believing that this is going to encourage your soul, and hopefully our prayer is that it might even be the catalyst for some change in your life. And so let's pray together, believing, expecting, anticipating that God will speak to us through this word. Jesus, we just thank you. We thank you that you're alive, you're active, you're moving in our lives. I pray for anyone who is watching this, wherever they're at, God, on their journey. Pray that you would meet them through your spirit, through your truth of who you are, God. Believe that you could change our lives. We pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Many years ago, I heard this story about this caretaker of a stream in the Alps. And it was this beautiful stream that a community just was surrounded by. And oftentimes the children in that community would go to that stream and they would play there, and that was their source of life. And there was so much beauty in that area. And they had hired a caretaker to oftentimes go to the stream and take out debris. And he would go there and he would make sure that there was nothing that was disrupting the life that was occurring in the stream and surrounding it. Well, after many years would go by, they would start to notice that the man, he was kind of quiet. Oftentimes, he would go unnoticed, but yet he would do his job. And so the stream would be abundant and lively, and life would flourish from all around it, but yet the man who was taking care of it was quiet and would go unnoticed. And the city just had made the decision, the community, they said, we're going to take the funds that we're using to pay this man, and we're going to put them elsewhere because we're deeming it just not worth it anymore. Well, after time had gone by, some started to notice, many didn't notice that the stream wasn't the same, and that a lot of the life that was surrounding it, the animals, the fish, and just the beauty around it, all this debris started to fall into the stream and these toxins, and it started to become brackish, and it just wasn't as beautiful as it used to be. And after a certain amount of time, the community noticed that as soon as they had taken the keeper away from the stream, it started to digress. It started to become less beautiful. It started to become less lively. And what you have to know is that your soul is like that stream. And you are the keeper of that stream. You are the keeper of your soul. And that you actually have a choice every day to take care of your soul or to let it go unnoticed. And what I love about the story is that the community, they had decided after it had gotten to a certain point of where they were like, oh, this is, I don't know if we could even reverse this. They had brought the man back, and he brought the stream over time back to It's health. And so if you feel like your soul, or you feel like your heart or your mind or your relationship with God is too far gone to get back to health again, it's just not true. And there's always hope for a new, fresh start, for things to change, for things to shift. But what you have to know is that it's actually a choice to take care of yourself. It's a choice to take care of the most inward part of who you are, the most valuable part of who you are. What makes you you is your soul. And I love that your soul is the inward part of you. It's the summation of your mind, your body, and your will. And because you have a soul, this is not just evidence for God. It points us to God in our life and our need for God in our life. Psalm 62 verse 1 says this. It says, "Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him." The opposite of rest is restlessness. And I could imagine, even right now as you're watching this, I'm sure many of you have experienced at least some form of exhaustion, anxiety, fear, and maybe some uncertainty about what is happening in your world that has caused your soul, the most inward part of who you are, to feel restless. And there is hope to once again find rest in God. But the only place that you're going to find that is in connection to God. And really the only point that I have for you in this talk is this, is that 2021, your biggest resolution this year has to be finding the resolve you need to start to get alone with God again. And here's the kicker, is that nobody is going to notice. Nobody is going to see it. The most important thing that you get to do this year is something that no one will know about, but yet everyone will see by the fruit of your life. No one's going to know how much time you spent with God today. Nobody's going to know how much time you spent opening up God's word this week. Nobody's going to know the last time you had an honest conversation with God, or even just talk to God like he actually loves you, instead of talking to God like it's just, I'm going to write down my list of things that I need from God, instead of just having a relationship with God, an open, honest relationship with God. And the space that you find rest and healing for your soul can only be found in solitude. It can only be found when you start to get alone with God. And I wonder what your life would look like if you started to make space for solitude in your life. I wonder what your life would start to look like. I wonder how much longer your fuse would be for your friends or your family or for your parents or for the situations that you get into or you fall into, whether it's your fault or not. I wonder how much longer your fuse would be if you were more reliant and trusting on God and found true soul rest inside of you. Somebody who has true soul rest is not shaken by the things of this world, because they're connected that to something that is outside of these circumstances. It's like Jesus. I love this about Jesus. Is that some of you may not know the story about Jesus literally sleeping in the middle of a storm in a boat while all of his disciples are freaking out. And Jesus, this is the God that we serve. This is the God that knows how to sleep in a storm. If you want to know how to rest, find true soul rest, just ask Jesus. He knows what it really means to find rest. But yet our inherent response to circumstances that seem grim, things or situations, a storm in our life comes in, and we just want to run around and go like, "God, wake up. Do you even care? We're drowning out here." And Jesus is just like, "I got this. It's okay." And he knows how to speak to our fear and speak to the wind and speak to the waves, rebuke the wind, rebuke the waves, and change the circumstance. But even in the middle of it, he has true rest, true ease. I want nothing more for you this year than for you to find that kind of resolve in your life, for you to find a new level of faith. What if God is calling to you this year to not do bigger things or serve in bigger ways this year? Maybe he is calling you to do that stuff, but maybe the thing that he's calling you to do more than anything else that everyone else sees is just to meet with him, to be with him, to make margin in your life, to seek God. I love this. In Psalm 42, it says, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. My soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I will remember you. In your greatest times of need, God will give you what you need. And that's him. It's not a thing. It's not some larger than life answer to a situation. It's just his presence. And the psalmist knows all too well. He's saying, my soul thirsts for God. I know why I'm discouraged. I know why I'm downcast. And it's not because I'm in a bad situation. It's not because 2020 didn't treat me well. It's not because of A, B, or C. It's because my soul needs God, and I haven't been connecting with him. And I need to make some space right now to go seek him. That's our resolution this year. That's my resolution this year. I wonder what your response should be when somebody asks you, oh, you got any goals this year? Yeah, I'm going to rest more. What? Yeah, I'm going to rest more. Excuse me? What is that? Yeah, I'm going to rest in God more this year. What does that even mean? No, yeah, I'm going to seek God. I'm going to make space for God this year. That's my biggest goal. Yeah. What? That is the complete opposite of our culture. That is the complete opposite of the world that we live in. We live in a world that marks your worth to your success. We live in a world that idolizes and props up materialism within our culture and says, if you can achieve this, then you're worthy. All the while, your soul, the most important part about you, saying, that's not what I need. That's actually not what I need. What I need is true, authentic, consistent connection with God. That's what you need. That's what I need. So if you want to go through this year even stronger, maybe that make that your resolution. I'm going to rest in God this year. I'm going to make more time in my life to spend with God. And I'll promise you this, you will not regret it. You will not regret it. Let's pray together. Jesus, we love you so much. We thank you that when we seek you, you respond. When we seek your face, you show up. And sometimes, God, you show up in ways that we never thought or even imagined you could. And I'm praying, God, that you would show up in ways of which whoever's watching never seen before, that they would know that they haven't even scratched the surface yet of their faith. They haven't scratched the surface yet of seeing your character. They haven't scratched the surface yet on all the things that you could do in their life. We love you so much, Jesus. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.